Now we'll run through the three different classifications based on the solids. So first is the wet digestion. So our solids are less than 20%. And in the flow chart on the left, you can see some of the pre-processing we talked about, and it might be a little bit different. This one shows a pulper, moves into a digester. Here it's showing one, there could be two as we just looked over. Then we've got our biogas coming off, going to utilizations, which we'll talk about later. And then our digestate coming out, and we might have to do a few things with that before we can apply it to the land and plug it into that circular economy for nutrients. On the right is a picture of a CSTR. This is the City of Toronto's Disco Road facility. And you can see the large vertical reactors. So pretty efficient on space, being able to put those big vertical tanks in. The next one we'll look at is a high solid slurry system. This one we'll look at a vertical one, and I'll show you a horizontal one as well. So you'll notice in this flowchart, it's not showing that pre-processing on the front end, because normally this is really done on the back end for this type of system. And since the material is really thick, it's really hard to pump. It's like kind of like sucking oatmeal through a straw kind of thing. So these systems have to have special pumps to move the material around through the system. In the picture on the right, you'll see an example of a vertical system. So it kind of looks similar to the wet AD. We've got a big vertical tank. The material in that tank would just be moving differently than it does in the continuously stirred system. On the ground, you can see there's three engines, which would be using the biogas. And on the left of the photo, you can see that looks like a holding tank for the finished digestate with a flexible top to capture the gas. And then if we take this big tall reactor and put it sideways, you'll get something like this. So this barn kind of looking thing in the middle of the picture is the reactor. There's a gas holder up here in the front left where the biogas would be stored temporarily. And then you can see some engines with the stacks down here where the biogas would be used. And just for a little look inside, and I like this because it shows kind of the residence time of the material as it goes through. So it all comes through it here green. You can see the little pieces of vegetables. And then as it moves through the plug together, it's going through all those stages, the hydrolysis, acidogenesis, acetogenesis, methanogenesis, as it goes through the reactor. So by the time you get to the end, all these food pieces have been degraded and all that stuff of the same age, that digestate is coming out. Our last one is the stackable system. So this one is kind of the most different to the other two. So instead of pumping material around, we're loading it up into the tunnel here and then raining material down on it and then circulating that water back onto it. So because we have all these microbes that need to use the products of the other microbes to continue the reaction, we need to make sure that all those products are carried throughout our pile. And that's what that leachate circulation does. We can also see at the bottom here, there's a little wet digester. So some of that leachate we can actually put in its own digester to degrade and produce more biogas. And in our example on the right here, this is the Surrey biofuels facility in the Lower Mainland in BC. And in the top picture, these you can see all the doors to these percolate bunker reactors. So if you open these up, you see the waste sitting inside and the nozzles for the moisture on top and the drains in the floor. This is outside the picture below, and you can see the one here on the right would be the wet digester for that leachate to degrade in, and then a gas holder beside it to hold all the gas coming off this process as well as out of the tunnels. So at the end of that digestion process, we're going to have possibly three things to deal with: residue, digestate, and wastewater. So the residue is that contamination we've removed at the front end. The digestate is going to be at a different level of moisture depending on our technology used. And then depending on what we do to our residue and digestate, we might have some wastewater to deal with as well. So any stream we want to remove water from, we can apply a dewatering technology. So similar to what you might have seen for wastewater sludge, we can use a centrifuge and whip it around and it will expel the water and retain the solids. We can use a press, which will squish it down and push the water out and keep our solids. And there's different kinds. There's like a screw press, belt press, filter press. So all those could be applied to digestate, which is pretty homogeneous by this point. Residue, you would probably want to put in a press rather than a centrifuge just because it's heterogeneous and they need to be balanced and things like that to work well. So in the picture on the right, you can see a nice dry, this would be a biosolids after dewatering with a press. Compare that to the pictures we saw earlier of that like wet 80% moisture input that would be going to a wet process. And you can imagine if you're trucking something around or sending it to composting, it's going to be way nicer to have it at this level of moisture. So you might apply dewatering to your digestate or your residue to make it easier to manage. The downside of doing that is now you have a water stream to deal with as well. So at the very end, after we've done our dewatering, we've got residue, digestate, and effluent. Residue probably is going to be landfilled or it could be incinerated. If you want to really use it for the best possible purpose, you can sort it a little bit more and see if you can take out recyclables and then send the rest to further processing to optimize it for incineration to make like a refuse-derived fuel product, RDF. Our digestate. Now, there's a number of ways that you can go about applying digestate. We're going to talk about that later. So you can apply whole digestate. So without dewatering it, you can dewater it and apply the digestate directly. You can sell even the liquid that's dewatered from it as a fertilizer, or you can send it to further processing such as composting or drying or other processes before it gets applied. So there's a number of options here. If you can get away with marketing whole digestate, there's the less effort to do at the facility, but there's drawbacks to that method as well, and you might want to go for more processing. Lastly, our effluent, so any water we've produced. So you can avoid this by not dewatering, but there's a lot of reasons you would want to dewater. This effluent can be used as process water as much as possible. So on one hand, it reduces your freshwater inputs. On the other hand, it lets you re-inoculate some of your bugs back into the system and reuse, so that's good. But if you have a lot of effluent and you can't discharge it to your sewer, then you'll have to build a wastewater treatment plant at your anaerobic digester. And a lot of digesters have their own little wastewater treatment plants. So again, wastewater treatment plants and digesters, they're kind of silly because you're destroying energy sources, but you do need to do that to meet wastewater discharge criteria. So if there's a way to use some of that energy without spending more energy to destroy it, that would be better, but wastewater treatment is required at a lot of facilities based on how they're set up and where they are operating.